What if Earth really was just a starter planet and it's finally time to level up? For years, we've heard that there's no planet B. But what if that was wrong? With advanced tech and interplanetary ambition, where would we go first, Mars or Venus? Terraforming Venus sounds insane. But on today's episode of the Infographic Show, we're exploring why it might not just be Earth's future, but its only hope. Before we start to load the space shuttle with luggage, let's take a closer look at all the reasons Venus might actually be a better candidate for terraforming than Mars. And trust us, there are more than you would expect. Venus is about the same size as Earth, so it has about the same gravity. Earth's gravity acceleration is on average 32 feet per second per second, while Venus's is only a little bit lower at 29 feet per second per second. Mars, in contrast, has only a gravity acceleration of about 12 feet per second per second. This is one definitive thing that Venus has over Mars from a colonization standpoint. Spending a prolonged time in a low-gravity environment has been shown to have a number of serious health consequences for humans. Medical studies done on astronauts suggest that living in low gravity leads to a loss of bone density, lower plasma counts, and muscular atrophy. Over time, this can lead to serious cardiovascular problems. In short, even if all the terraforming goes well, living on Mars might still kill you. And that wasn't in the brochure. A manned trip to Mars would require astronauts to live in zero gravity for the 6 to 9 month journey, depending on who you travel with. They would then need to practice a strict exercise regimen in order to be able to be capable of standing by the time they reach the planet. Furthermore, a successful Mars colony would need to have some kind of artificial gravity setup, which, while it is a mainstay in the sci-fi movies, it is not something we really know how to make happen. And if we somehow miraculously did create artificial gravity, that could come with some pretty nightmarish pitfalls too. If there was a technical glitch and the machine went into overdrive, everyone would get turned into pink mist. Therefore, setting our sights on a planet with gravity closer to our own cuts out a lot of time and effort that would need to be spent on how to keep the residents of our space colony healthy. Getting to Venus would be a lot cheaper and faster than getting to Mars. It would take the same amount of energy to get off the Earth, of course, but since Venus is closer to the Sun's gravitational pull would do most of the work once the craft was out in space. Compare this to a Mars mission, which would have to expend extra energy to get further out into the solar system, against that gravitational pull. It's believed that a trip to Venus would be 30 to 50% shorter than a trip to Mars. Also, there are no meteors and fewer cosmic rays, neither of which are great for your health. Just like Earth, Venus's atmosphere protects it from the kind of bombardments that would make constructing anything long-term on Mars a real pain. And well, that is kind of all there is for benefits. You might be thinking, wait, didn't you just say Venus has an atmosphere and Mars basically doesn't? Even if it's not breathable, isn't it easier to work with something that's already there than to build up an atmosphere from scratch? And here is where things get complicated. Venus does have an atmosphere, but it's almost entirely carbon dioxide and it's roughly 90 times thicker than the Earth's atmosphere. That thickness would be deadly to anyone trying to land on the surface of Venus. It would be equivalent to the crushing pressures found at the bottom of Earth's oceans. Every single one of the 10 probes that have landed on Venus have been destroyed extremely quickly. The longest-lived one only managed to survive for about 127 minutes before being crushed. And then there's the other big problem, the surface temperature. Venus is 26.1 million miles closer to the Sun than we are, and its rotation is significantly longer than its orbit. Venus takes about 224 Earth days to orbit the Sun, but 243 Earth days to make a single rotation. That means on Venus, the Sun stays in the sky for almost the entire year. Combine that with the greenhouse effect produced by those millions of tons of carbon dioxide, and that leaves you with an average surface temperature of 867 degrees Fahrenheit, which is hot enough to melt lead. And if that isn't bad enough, on top of the heat, the lack of oxygen, and the crushing atmospheric pressure, it also rains sulfur. That's right, the golden yellow clouds that you see in all the satellite photos of Venus are full of sulfur, which rains down onto the surface as sulfuric acid. No wonder scientists often call this planet Earth's evil twin. But still, human beings love to rise to a challenge, and if we are good at anything, it's using our big wet brains to reshape our environments to our benefit. If 40,000 years ago ancient people could terraform Australia into something livable using only Stone Age technology, then with our modern space-age tech, whipping Venus into shape should be easy. And in theory, it is. Scientists have got a pretty clear idea about the steps it would take. The problems only start when you think about how much time and resources you would need to pull something like this off. terraforming the planet of love. If we were to do it, it would be a process made up of four major steps. Step one would be to turn down the temperature a little. Now on Earth, where climate change is mostly man-made, lowering the temperature is an issue of changing people's energy consumption habits. As hard as it might be to convince Jeff Bezos not to buy another private jet, it's even harder to stop the runaway global warming on Venus, especially since it happened naturally over billions of years. Politicians can stop taking money from big oil at any time, but Venus can't really help the fact that she is really close to the sun. So what do we do? One option would be to knock Venus out of orbit somehow, and that would speed up its rotation, shortening the length of a Venusian day, and limiting the amount of sunlight the planet is exposed to for extended periods. However, this also is way beyond the capabilities of our scientific understanding, so it's definitely not practical. Also, who knows what other horrifying consequences fundamentally shifting the orbit patterns of our solar system might have. It's probably not worth the risk. Another option would be to use chemical processes to bind and store the carbon dioxide. This is well within the scope of our abilities. Carbon capture has proven effective in cutting CO2 emissions by up to 90% at some power plants here on Earth. The Boundary Dam Power Station in Saskatchewan, Canada, began using carbon storage technology back in 2014. But the problem is, even if you can build the infrastructure required to filter and store the CO2 from Venus's atmosphere, you then, somehow, need to get it to Venus. And because of the density of the atmosphere, landing anything on Venus would be a complete nightmare. So we probably won't be able to do that either. So the most effective way to cool Venus down might be just to stick it in the shade for a bit. Using an array of artificial satellites coated in reflective materials, we might be able to literally just block out the sun until the surface of Venus freezes. This would also partially take care of that atmosphere problem too. As the surface cools, so would the air, causing the carbon dioxide to take on a liquid state and rain down onto the planet's surface. And there, it would settle into a frozen layer that could be dealt with later. This would also relieve the pressure, since with all that CO2 solidified, the nitrogen and sulfur left behind would only be about 3 times Earth's surface pressure, which is a far cry better than 90. It's a deceptively simple solution, with one major downside. The process of cooling Venus down this way could take centuries. Once the carbon dioxide is frozen, the next step would be to somehow get rid of it. On Earth, trapped carbon is usually stored underground. But if the entire surface of the planet was coated with it, well, it would be a massive undertaking to dig through that to the rock underneath. We could potentially import new soil from Mercury to cover the CO2, but that would only be a temporary solution. In January 2020, astronomers found evidence that Venus, like the Earth, has or at one point had active volcanoes on its surface. From this far away, they can't give a timeline on volcanic eruptions more precise than within the past 2 million years. But if a volcano erupted on Venus while we were in the process of freezing the atmosphere, the heat would rapidly melt the frozen carbon layer, releasing the CO2 back up into the air and putting us right back at square one. So the most sustainable solution for the carbon problem might be to chop up the frozen CO2 into small manageable chunks and then shoot it out into space. This could be done using a fixed mass driver, a theoretical piece of technology also known as a space gun. A mass driver is basically a cannon full of sequential rows of electromagnets that can be used to accelerate a magnetized payload. Fixed mass drivers have been a theoretical method of space travel since all the way back in the Victorian era, when Jules Verne wrote From Earth to the Moon, a direct route in 97 hours 20 minutes. In practice, these machines would actually be woefully inefficient for transporting people from the Earth to the Moon. But in theory, they would work fine as a way of shooting small objects into space. With a few fixed mass drivers, we could catapult the frozen CO2 away using a fraction of the energy that a rocket launch would use, and the frozen CO2 wouldn't be completely useless once it's shot off the planet. It could be consolidated and stored as a fuel source for later. Using recycled CO2 as a fuel source isn't even as fantastical as it sounds. In fact, it is something we're already developing as a way to use up the excess CO2 on our own planet. In 2024, researchers at the University of Queensland, Australia, built a generator that uses chemical gel to split carbon dioxide molecules into ions that produce an electric charge. In the 2 centuries it might take to fully freeze Venus's atmosphere, who knows? We could develop CO2-powered generators on a scale large enough to turn all that carbon into fuel for future space colonization projects. Okay, now we've gotten rid of the CO2. The planet Venus is still freezing cold and the air is unbreathable. We need to introduce oxygen and heat back into the mix. But to heat Venus back up, we couldn't just take the sunshades away. The intense sunlight would make the planet instantly unlivable. But for a different reason this time. The mirrored solar shades would need to be positioned to artificially break up Venus's insane 5,832-hour rotation, creating a day-night cycle more like the Earth's. If we could pull that off, the surface temperature would gradually drop to bearable levels, and for the first time, Venus could be ready to hold liquid water. Where we get the water is an open question. Some scientists believe there might be water underground on Venus, but more studies would need to be done to confirm it. For now, the most realistic option would be harvesting ice from comets, asteroids, or the rings of Saturn, or the ice moons like Europa. This would be a huge undertaking that would likely take decades, but it could be done with technology that we currently understand. Once the planet's surface had enough liquid water, it would finally be time to jump over the final hurdle of terraforming Venus – oxygen. This is the step that, on a long enough timeline, would be the most hands-off. Based on what we know about how life started on our own planet, the easiest way to generate oxygen on a barren planet would be to fill the oceans with cyanobacteria, a type of microorganism that produces energy via photosynthesis. These bacteria, which are found basically everywhere, are thought to be the first life forms to have evolved on the Earth. We can thank these little guys for our oxygen-rich atmosphere, as well as the nutrients in our soil. They can metabolize nitrogen into ammonium, nitrates, and nitrites, essential building blocks for complex life. From here, things would progress the same as they did on the Earth billions of years ago, and Venus would finally be move-in ready. It only took us hundreds of years and probably trillions of dollars that would have been better spent on literally anything else. So as you can see, terraforming Venus is a bit of a fool's errand. This is to say nothing of the potential ethical or ecological concerns of this project. You might be wondering how there could possibly be ethical concerns in colonizing another planet. Well, there's actually a surprising amount of evidence to suggest there might already be life there. In UV photographs of Venus, scientists have noticed dark lines in the clouds that have no known explanation. In 1963, Carl Sagan hypothesized that these lines might represent a colony of microorganisms that absorb UV radiation for energy. In 2024, after multiple studies of readings taken from Venus flyover missions, it was confirmed that phosphine was present in Venus's atmosphere, phosphine being a compound that is not known to come from any abiotic processes. A recent MIT study into the stability of amino acids in a variety of liquids found that sulfuric acid is surprisingly far more hospitable than you would expect. This has huge implications when it comes to the possibility of life on Venus, as it implies that other liquids could sustain life in the way that we used to think only liquid water could. Even though we know nothing can survive on the planet's surface, the upper parts of the atmosphere are likely to be significantly cooler. And given that the density of the atmosphere is comparable to Earth's oceans, it's possible that some sulfur-drinking, single-celled life forms are swimming around in the clouds. But of course, there's no way to prove or disprove the theory until the Venus Life Finder mission launches in 2026 and comes back with some Venusian air samples. Similarly, it's long been suspected that Jupiter's ice moon Europa could be home to complex life under the surface. Europa is a little bit smaller than Earth's moon, and it's covered in a thick sheet of ice. Since scientists have observed the formation of cracks and dark spots in that ice, it's generally agreed upon that there is a liquid ocean under the surface. This ocean is heated by a mix of geothermal vents and tidal friction, and it contains twice as much water as Earth's oceans. And that makes it a no-brainer in the search for alien life. In 2023, the James Webb Telescope found evidence of carbon dioxide deposits coming from cracks in the ice, which provides another piece of evidence that Europa's ocean is habitable to simple forms of life, like tube worms and algae. Though, like with Venus, there is no way to tell until we send a probe there to collect samples. Either way, harvesting Europa's ice and water to supply man-made oceans on Venus could be seriously detrimental to any of its inhabitants that may or may not exist. For the Venus terraforming project to go through smoothly, we'd first have to confirm that both Venus and our water source were completely devoid of life. Otherwise, we would risk wiping out entire ecosystems before they've even had a chance to be discovered. But luckily, there is another, much less invasive option when it comes to putting people on Venus. Just don't bother with the surface at all. We could just build it in the clouds. Scientists have estimated that at an altitude of about 31 miles above the surface, not only is the air cooler, but the pressure is a lot closer to the Earth's, or at least close enough that all man-made structures wouldn't just be crushed within minutes. and the denser atmosphere would mean that it wouldn't actually take that much energy for a large craft to stay airborne. And as we mentioned before, solar radiation and meteors wouldn't be much of a worry, so we could theoretically build a colony of interconnected floating cities, which we think personally would be pretty awesome. The biggest hurdle would be choosing corrosion-resistant building materials that could withstand constantly being pelted with sulfuric acid. But in the search to build a more resistant surface rover to send to Venus, scientists have had promising results testing coatings made of ceramic and certain types of plastic. Provided these materials could be produced on a large scale, they could be used to build floating structures. These structures could even be made self-sustaining with technology that's already available to us. Venus has wind speeds of up to 220 miles per hour, which could be used to generate electricity. The carbon dioxide in Venus's atmosphere could be used as a fuel source as well. All there would be to do is to supply the floating cities with a sustainable water supply and the materials to start growing plants. Pretty soon, you'd have floating ships complete with clean energy generators and breathable air. Would it take a long time to get this kind of project off the ground? Absolutely. But it would be way, way less than the centuries or potentially millennia that it would take to make the planet's surface hospitable to human beings. So while we'll probably never be able to actually terraform Venus, the idea of one day living there might not be a total pipe dream after all. Ultimately, you might be wondering what the point of all this is. Space travel is time-consuming, dangerous, and costly. Surely the best use of everyone's energy is on other things, like solving world hunger and curing cancer. But the thing is, there is actually a lot of value to be found in studying Venus. Through trying to learn more about how life could possibly exist there, we end up learning a lot about how life evolved on the Earth. And even more importantly, we end up learning things that can help us in the fight against climate change. Because Venus is a pretty good representation of what the Earth might look like in a couple of centuries if we don't start acting soon. And we don't want to end up like Venus. So the same research that might one day help us make Venus habitable could also help us figure out how to clear the CO2 out of our own atmosphere. Research into colonizing Venus is really a win-win for everyone. If we never actually make it to Venus, we'll at least make huge advances in carbon capture and renewable energy technology. And if we do someday in the far-flung future turn Venus into a tropical paradise, well then, we would have two habitable planets. So in the end, maybe Venus isn't our evil twin after all, maybe she's just misunderstood. If Venus is too hostile to fix, well maybe the red planet's our best bet. Or is it? Watch The Real Problem with Living on Mars to find out why settling there might be harder than you think. Or click on this video instead.